I'm Shelley Cohen-Conrad. I'm the Director of Interprofessional Education here at UNE, and it's always wonderful to see everybody's faces. I guess my next job is to turn this over to Alban, who I know, thank you, who will be talking about the Wellness Initiative, Center of Wellness Initiative. And you will continue. Thank you.
Thank you. Bon appétit. I will do this in French. How many of you are French speakers? Just one, so maybe I'll do this in English. How many of you can pronounce my name, Alban? That's pretty good. So my name is Alban. I've been living in Maine for the past 3 years and working on a project called the Center of Wellness Leadership. Coming from France, I don't know if you know that in France, most of our alternative medicine and healthcare system is reimbursed by our socialist government. And it's a good thing. We don't pay for education and we don't pay for healthcare. And it's a tremendous advantage. So very early on in my life, I was used to go and see my PCP and be provided with homeopathy and osteopathy, and this is part of my natural life. So when I came here, I was offered the position of the director of a small non-for-profit that was launched a year ago called the Center of Wellness Leadership. And I invite you all to go to wellnessleadership.org. Because what we've done in the past year is to provide to the members of our community information about complementary and alternative medicine. So if you're looking for any sort of information related to yoga, Chinese acupuncture, homeopathy, rolfing, or anything else revolving in that ecosystem of what do we do to help our healthcare, we don't, as you know, probably better than I do, we don't cure diseases with pills. We cure it by having a healthy life, by doing exercise, by eating well, and by also finding alternative ways to deal with our healthcare. And most of the time, I don't know how many of you are familiar with homeopathy, for example. Can you raise your hand? Okay, about a fifth of the audience today. What about osteopathy? Are you familiar with it? Again, a fifth of it. And Chinese medicine and herbal treatments. So we have a few of you that are familiar with it, have heard of it, but we thought it was very important for us to rise awareness around all the other types of medicine that have been going on for thousands of years. So go to wellnessleadership.org, and we're very honored and grateful to have Dr. Nevens here as part of our advisory board members, along with other practitioners that represent the different modalities that we are talking about. We also finance pilot studies, and we're working with academic partners, and all sorts of information will be provided to you on the website, and they're all evidence-based. This is what I want to say to you is, you know, we do a lot of research, and everything that you'll be seeing on our website has been vetted by our advisory board and doctors. But the reason why I'm here today is to invite you all to our very first symposium. And I think it's going to interest, hopefully, most, if not every one of you, on October 29th, and I've left on your tables some flyers. We're organizing the very first symposium revolving around integrative health and athletic performances. So we're going to talk about sports. How do you prevent injuries? Or how do you use post-injuries? And how do you use CAM modalities to prevent injuries, or in your daily routine. We're going to have practitioners from all over Maine come to talk to us about sports medicine and athletes, Olympians. We're going to have Julia Cloquet and Dave Cowens for the Celtics. It's going to be a very interactive, fun day. The speakers will only speak 20, 25 minutes. It will be an interactive way to deal with the audience. It starts at 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning. And hands at 2 o'clock. We're going to have rifles, lots of foods. It's going to be really a fun. I wanted this to be a very fun and interactive event. And because I know, having been a student myself, that we don't have a lot of money to attend to those symposiums, I've decided to offer to all UNE students, so you and all your peers can come and attend the symposium for free. So I will give Shelley the code that you need to enter on Eventbrite, and if you go to wellnessleadership.org, you can register and come and attend, and you won't have to pay anything. And that's my talk for today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aldon. Sounds wonderful. Can't wait for that. I am Kali Johnson, counselor here. I am here to introduce our main speaker today, Gregory Nevens, health psychologist, complementary and alternative medicine man. And there's so much to say. Well, I will tell you that Greg Nevens is on the executive board of the American Association of Integrative Medicine. He has actually written parts of the study course and the national exam for integrative certification. And he teaches in Maine Med's Integrative Medicine's fellowship programs. So lots and lots of experience. He is a practitioner and regular at UNICOM CBL. And today, he is going to lead for us an interactive discussion about some needed paradigm shifts and evolving hybrid integrative intervention systems. And I know that some of these he researched and put together for others to use, as well as what he uses and through his wisdom. He will stun you, really, when he makes a presentation regarding systems impacting chronic conditions through the lens of today, two chronic pain cases that you will hear about involving musculoskeletal pain, PTSD, and chronic lumbar pain. That's a lot for us to solve in this hour, but I think we can do so with Greg's leadership. And he used colors too. You'll learn about that as well. I was talking to a colleague yesterday about Greg Nevens, and that individual said, "Oh, Greg Nevens, he's a whirlwind of knowledge." Yes. So, with further no ado, thank you.
Okay, so integrative medicine has been an interest of mine for 35 years. I started in an integrative medicine colloquium of different practitioners, including doctors and nurses, etc., 35 years ago, called the Health Psychology, the Holistic Center, or the Whole Health Group. And that experience convinced me that we were approaching medicine in the way it ought to be approached. We would talk about different cases, we'd have case conferences, we'd look at different alternative ways of approaching different problems. And so it's kind of been my guiding light ever since in terms of my advocacy in local and national systems to try to get integrative medicine more utilized. So I'm going to talk to you today because so many people now are aware of basics of Chinese traditional medicine, basics of Ayurveda medicine, especially yoga. Most of the popularity of integrative medicine has been driven by the grassroots. 70% of patients going to PCPs these days are involved in one aspect of integrative medicine or another. So Western medicine is having to pay attention to that. And can we do the next slide? So we're here at IPEC, which is to expose you all to teamwork, interprofessional teamwork, which you're all going to be involved in when you get out into the real world. Not all of you, but most of you are going to be in venues where teamwork is very much a part of the process. What I would hope for, and what I do hope for, and what I see beginning to happen, is that integrative medicine becomes part of that team. Usually, or ideally, some members of the team do have a broad knowledge of integrative medicine because they need that as they're dealing with patients who are involved in integrative medicine. And more individual practitioners have developed their own modality or taken on their own CAM or integrative medicine modality within their specialty area. There's only one PT person here, I noticed, but Dan Katz, who's also on the CWL board, is a PT person who also practices acupuncture, and I wouldn't go to any other PT practitioner other than him. He's helped me a lot with a variety of my own issues over time. Okay, so let's talk about some integrative paradigm shifts. We no longer need to talk about East or West. We can start talking about East and West. And we can talk about ancient and modern and the integrative medicine intervention systems, which excite me the most, that I'm going to talk to you about today, are very much an integrative of ancient and modern. One, auricular therapy was originated in China. We're going to talk a little bit about that. But most of the technology, most of the science, most of the points involved were discovered in France and Germany over the last 70 years. We're going to talk about another intervention system that's based on ancient Ayurveda chakra system, and we're going to talk about another one that's based on acupuncture, but both of those also utilize modern technology and approaches to health. Whoops, no, don't need it yet. So body-mind has become much more accepted. We're no longer having to deal with the Cartesian split between mind and body is now more and more irrelevant. Less and less people try to reinforce the Cartesian split as a model. But most importantly, we're talking about the difference between energy and mass. So how would you like to do a little exercise with energy? Good? Let's get up and move around a little bit and make this more informal. So what I want you to do is stand up. And now I want you to, it might be helpful to get in a Tai Chi Wu position, which is turn your toes a little inward, put your heels about shoulder apart, tuck your butt down below so that you flatten the lower part of your back. This is called the Wu Qi position. It's where we start when we do Qigong exercises, Tai Chi exercises. It's a nice, grounded place to do energy work from. So I'm going to ask you to just rub your hands together. And now separate them by about 6 or 8 inches. And I just want you to pay attention, be present, and just pay attention to the area between the palms of your hands. Now you just created friction, so of course the hands are warmer. But see if you can sense an energy flow between the palms of your hands. Okay? How many felt that energy flow? Raise your hand. Okay? All right. So now the question becomes, how do we take that energy and affect the body? Or can that energy affect somebody else's body? Is the slide available for the next slide about quantum physics? Did we pass it? Quantum, yeah, we passed it. Okay, so quantum physics is all about the difference between mass and energy. When Einstein, Bohm, all the others first started looking at quantum physics, they were interestingly involved in the study of light, which is what most of my work is involved with. And what they found was they could prove that light was mass because they could prove experiments where protons would impact a screen and that would show that light is mass. They could design other experiments that showed energy is, or light is energy belonging to wavelengths. But they could never see the two at the same time. What I think we're starting to see is an evolution in human consciousness where we can entertain the notion that we can see both energy and mass and how they're involved in health and that kind of thing. And that's a very exciting time to me. So one of the conundrums involved, or one of the enigmas that bothered the early physicists, was that in the act of observing energy, you change what you see. So you can never see very objectively what the energy is, because as soon as you start to look at it, and especially with a certain intention, it changes, okay? Another principle is that of non-local causality. We're about to do a little experiment with non-local causality. And later on, we'll hopefully see some cases that can be changed with a quantum leap in terms of changing the energy system in a body, either preventatively or in terms of working with an illness. So the next step is, can we use the energy we just felt to create a change in the body? Can I have a volunteer and a sip of water? I'm going to ask Evan to create an O-ring using your ring finger and your thumb on your left hand, okay? And what I want you to do is hold that as tight as you possibly can. Got it? Okay, that's pretty tight. Okay. Would you test that?
Sure.
He's good. You know, I'm going to make his O-ring better, okay? All right, so what we're going to do is a little experiment to see if we can change the energy system in this body. We're going to do that with working with the Ren channel, which is also known as the conception vesicle in the front of his body. We're going to just take the energy out of that conception vesicle and see what it does to the strength in his O-ring. Then we're going to put the energy back into the Ren channel, and we're going to see if that O-ring gets even stronger. Sound like a plan?
Sounds good.
All right. Yeah. is just try this yourselves. Have the person next to you create an O-ring, test it, take the energy out of the REN channel by visualizing energy moving out of this front channel, and test it again. It should be weaker. Put the energy back into that channel, visualizing the energy from your hand. This is when you felt, those of you who did feel the energy between the palms of your hand were feeling qi, or energy in terms of healing, energy in terms of Chinese medicine, prana in terms of Ayurvedic medicine. So just very quickly, create an O-ring, let your partner test it, see how strong or weak it is. Take the energy out. Use the back of your hand and go down the REN channel, which is right along the vagus nerve, and move the energy right out. And then retest the O-ring. It's going all right, but we're running out of time. Okay, and when you move your hands up, you're creating a stronger O-ring. So test the O-ring when you take the energy out, test the O-ring when you put it back in. And it should get stronger. Did it work? Okay. All right. Let's sit down. And I know this couple down here, it worked because when the practitioner tried to pull the O-wing apart, she almost pulled the person over because it got much, much stronger. Okay? How many people felt a difference between before and after the energy? Good. Okay. Let's move on. Back one. All right. So we just did a little experiment with energy. That's a paradigm shift, holistic versus reductionistic, individualized versus standardized. But we're now looking at both, because we're looking at a system where it's truly integrated. Outcomes research does not work the same for Eastern energy-based medicines as it does for pharmaceuticals. You can create double-bind systems for pharmaceuticals and get pretty solid results. But because of the what you just experienced in terms of the intention of the practitioner involved in the effectiveness of any energy technique, it can't be standardized quite as well. So outcome studies, chi-squares, comparing different techniques that we know work for different conditions or illnesses is the better way to go with research for alternative or energy-based medicine. Oh boy. We're going to do another experiential thing because it's important, okay? But we'll try not to spend too much time doing it. And the fact that you just had lunch probably isn't going to help that much with this. But what I'd like you to do is pull your chairs back and get a comfortable position with both feet on the floor. And we're going to do a little mindfulness exercise. How many people have done mindfulness? Okay. So this exercise, what I want you to do is close your eyes, take a couple of breaths, and just tune into your body. And I want to know where your attention goes in your body. I want you to know where the attention goes in your body. And I want you to pay attention to the sensation you feel in the part of your body that takes your attention. And I want you to see if you can get in touch with an emotion that's attached to that sensation. You're all subject to lots of stressors, anxiety producers, sadnesses on a regular basis, things that make you angry. If you tune into the air of your body that draws your attention right now, is there an emotion attached? And finally, I want you to pay attention to that part of your body and the emotion attached. And just create a blank screen in your mind. Try to think of nothing and see if you can come up with a memory of when you felt like that before. The earlier, the better. And you don't have to work at it. Just tune into the body sensation and the emotion attached. And see what image or memory comes up. Okay, so can I hear, see a raise of hands in who could identify or whose attention was drawn to a part of their body and can get into an associated emotion involved with that part of their body, and who could get a memory associated with when they've experienced that before? Excellent. Excellent. Okay. Of those people that got the memory and the emotion and the body arousal, how many, next slide. Further on. Yeah. How many experienced a tension or sensation in their chest or heart area? Excellent. Okay. And how many in the neck and shoulders? Okay. And how many in the head? Okay. And how many in the stomach? Only a couple. Might be because you just ate lunch too. Okay, so what was the emotion that you experienced in your chest? Relief? Okay.
Chest?
Excitement? Geez, you guys are all too well adjusted. How am I going to do something with you? Anybody else in the chest feel tension? Okay, you did. Okay. All right. And how many people, neck and shoulders, if you've done this, I do this mindfulness technique in almost everything I do. And there's patterns that develop. Okay. So people who feel discomfort in their stomach when they do this exercise, very often the emotion is anxiety, and it's separation anxiety and the memory that comes up is around separation anxiety. Neck and shoulders is a very common place to hold energy when you're stressed, sometimes when you're anxious, but also when you're angry. How many people noticed or attributed their neck and shoulder to tightness to stress? Okay. And anybody for anger? Good. Okay. All right. There was only one or two stomachs in the back, and they're still eating, so we won't worry about that. And one head. Okay. So I want you to do some work with each other. I want your partner to have, I'm going to work with this young lady here, but I want your partner to have the intention of moving that uncomfortable energy that you felt, okay? And you felt it in your head. Okay, I want your partner to go back and forth on kidney 27, which is right under your clavicle, above your first rib, in the depression, right next to your sternum, okay? If you're the person doing that, I want your intention to be that you're just putting healing energy. I want you to go back and forth, okay? What I want you to do is sit in the back of your head and be very objective and just kind of watch that energy and see what happens. It should move, okay? For neck and shoulders, you may have already known this. I've learned this way before I knew anything about acupuncture or Eastern medicine. There's a spot right in the web between your thumb and your forefinger. And if your partner goes back and forth on that sore spot, it will be sore because that's where you're feeling the energy. You should, again, sit in the back of your head and see if you can watch that energy in your neck and shoulders move. And angry. So, I'm going to have you work on a different acupressure point, okay? And that's gallbladder 20, which is right in the back of the head. And it's outside the muscles, right under the occiput. She's going to be able to tell you if it's tender or not. And you're just going to go back and forth. And you're going to watch that angry energy and see if it does anything, okay? And I'll work with you on pericardium 8 real quickly. So you're feeling some tension in your chest. Let's pull up a chair. One of them crosses a horizontal line. Right there is pericardium 8. Pericardium 8 is a protector of the heart. I've seen patients, I've been called out to a patient who has had an anxiety attack or a panic attack so badly in the parking lot that they became paralyzed. All you need to do is work with pericardium 8, and it tends to just loosen up and the panic attack can go away. So I'm going to ask you to sit in the back of your head, feel that tension in your chest, and that feels like anxiety, right? And I just want you to just sit in the back of your head and not think about anything but the fact that anxiety is excess energy. And just watch it and see if it moves. Now you're either smiling because it's moving or it's gone?
Yeah.
Okay. So we just moved anxious energy from this young lady's chest, and she's not feeling anxious anymore. So if you could do this for your patients, if you're a PA or an RN, or especially a PT, you got a patient who's got, you're working on their shoulder, you can feel their whole neck and shoulder areas tight, all you need to do is work on, oh no, we're not working on it, chest tight, okay? But when we work on neck and shoulders, if you can loosen that up, you're gonna do a better job of working with it. If you're an osteopathic physician and there's so much tension there that you can't manipulate or you can't move the limb around particularly well, trying some of these techniques to just move that energy and move that anxiety or anger or whatever it is works. Okay, so let's, those of you who felt it in your neck and shoulders, large intestine 4 is between the web of your first finger and your big thumb. And just go back and forth, just like I did, back and forth. There's a reason for that. Biphasic, what you're doing is stimulating the brain biphasically. Anxiety and tension and things like that tend to be on the right side of your brain. When you are biphasically stimulating the brain, you're moving the energy back and forth, and you're also having the left brain impact the right, or the anxiety. Most of the time when we're anxious, we're all in the right brain. Getting the left brain to talk to you is helpful. Okay, so let's try kidney 27 and large intestine 4, just for a few minutes, and see if you, as the practitioner, can go back and forth with intention of just moving energy, and as a patient, you can feel a shift in that energy system very quickly. Oh. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, if you need to ask permission to touch, ask permission. If the energy's in your head, kidney 27, if it's in your neck and shoulders, large intestine 4, in the web, and it will be sore, okay? Do you have a sore spot there? Is it a little tender? All right. All right, we got to move on. How many people felt a little change in the energy level? Good. So the stress and anxiety in the neck and shoulders released. And the head one, kidney 27, helps with anxiety in the head, but it also helps when people are dissociated. If you have a patient that's very dissociated, just working with kidney 27 will ground them. What kidney 27 does is it pulls the energy down your body all the way to your feet. And when you're there, you're grounded. We are halfway through and haven't covered anything, so let's move. All right, so what just happened was when I asked you to tune into your body, what you became aware of was arousal by a part of your brain called the insula. The insula is a two-way street, but it's a communication center between the mind and the body, especially the anterior cingulate gyrus. The anterior cingulate gyrus holds all your traumatic memories, but all your good memories. Both the insula and the anterior cingulate gyrus are centrally involved in many chronic illnesses. And that's one of the pieces of research that kind of supports that is the ACEs study. How many people have heard of the ACEs study? Okay, so childhood trauma, living in a situation where you're walking on eggshells all the time starts to impact your autonomic nervous system, developing problems later on. And we'll talk a little bit about that etiologically in a second. So, the insula is the mind-body connection. When you have an emotion, you tend to feel it somewhere or another. If you have frustration, you tend to feel it in your hands and arms because you're wanting to change the situation. You're wanting to fix it. You're wanting to solve the problem, but you may not have the ability or the power to do so. And we've talked about some of the other acupressure points. And emotions and where they show up in the system. Usually heart and chest are about relationships. Neck and shoulders are usually about daily stressors, that kind of thing, although anger can also come up there and that can be interpersonal. Cingulate gyrus. So the anterior cingulate gyrus is where we store all our emotional memory. And that can be traumatic memory, or it can be very positive memory. But what happened was you tuned into your insula, you became aware of what kind of emotion that stimulation or that sensory awareness was coming from, and then you got the memories, or a memory, along the neuronal network in your anterior cingulate gyrus that was causing that arousal. Do you understand? Got it? Okay. So where are we? So this is a functional MRI of emotional trauma. The two white areas on the top are the anterior cingulate gyrus, the two on the bottom are the insula. This is going to be important when we look at MRIs of chronic pain. Next. We've already done it. All right, I'm going to zip through the etiological paradigm shift. Best definition of the spectrum disorder, which etiologically is where we're going from a reductionistic view of pain and illness, focusing on the organ, focusing on the nerve root space in the spine, etc., to a more global central processing problem, especially in chronic pain. So, this is written, skip that one. All right, John W. Diamond is by far the most brilliant CAM writer and practitioner I know. He's from South Africa. He is a Western physician. He's also acupuncture master, master of Ayurveda, has some knowledge of indigenous South African medicine, and he's written the best book I know of on CAM techniques. And he talks about this spectrum disorder in terms of learned memory responses. So let me just give you a very, very quick example of how a childhood traumatic experience can end up being an adult problem. So, little girl gets lost in Macy's, separated from her mother at age 2, separated for 10 or 11 minutes. To a 2-year-old, 10 or 11 minutes is like a month, okay? She is on the brink of an abyss of anxiety. Her stomach, which is where separation anxiety shows up, jazzes up and she starts to cry. From then on, when she goes out with her mother, she's right at her mother's hip. If she goes to the pediatrician, she's not one of the ones that goes to the toys on the opposite end of the room. She stays right here, or if she goes to the toys, she keeps checking to make sure mom's still there. So she has this constant arousal and fear out in public. She goes to school the first day, 3 years later, gets on the bus, separation anxiety, waves goodbye to mom, feels the stomach ache, starts to cry, and the big kids on the back of the bus make fun of her. What that does is it takes that original trauma and creates more branches on that neuronal network. And over the lifespan, those can expand and expand. So then when she's in fourth grade, she has to memorize a poem. She has to stand up in front of the group and speak this poem. She freezes because there's big kids at the back of the room. She's filled with anxiety. Her stomach hurts. She might even cry. If the teacher then makes fun of her, she's got another branch about authority figures and another branch about speaking in front of other people. So let's say she goes through high school, she does fine, and then goes to college, does fine. She probably has a real tough time with any required public speaking course, but she gets through college, does fine. She goes, gets a job at UNE. Everything's going great, except then she gets promoted and has to give 5 presentations a week to 5 different teams. All of a sudden, every day, might be much more subtle, but that stomach is jazzing up, that anxiety is coming up, and it's happening over and over and over again. It's becoming a learned memory. Whoops. He doesn't say it there. But he calls it a learned memory response. So it's being repeated and repeated. Those nerves or the neuronal network in the anterior cingulate gyrate is becoming more and more sensitized, more and more able to be triggered left and right, and she ends up having a pre-ulcerous condition. So that's basically how it works. So the hypothesis based on the spectrum disorder, and we're going to talk a little more about chronic pain because that's the two cases, is that emotional trauma leads to static habituated neuronal networks in the ACG and insula. These neuronal networks can be activated by associated somatic, emotional, situational, visual, da-da-da-da-da. When activated, state-dependent gestalt, which includes some somatic and autonomic, emotional, and sometimes cognitive information, cumulative MRIs activate, strengthen, expand, and perhaps sensitize the neural network and gestalt. And when pain, injury, or sequelae to injury triggers these neural networks, the associated pain can become part of the habituated neuronal network. So one of the other places besides the insula that the anterior cingulate gyrus is connected to is the somatosensory cortex. The purpose of the anterior cingulate gyrus is to help you be in different situations and know whether it's a safe environment, safe situation where you can be yourself, let your hair down, or it's a place where you maybe need to sit in the back of your head and kind of, something's not quite right, you want to test it out a little bit, you don't want to put yourself out there too much, and then another environment or situation where you want to get the heck out of there, okay? So that's one of the purposes of the anterior cingulate gyrus. So we're adding the somatosensory cortex. The somatosensory cortex is the part that pain impulses, it does a discrimination of pain impulses. It tells you it's pain in your knee, it's a throbbing pain, it's a burning pain, it's a sharp shooting pain. It's a pain of a 7 or a 2. And again, this is attached to the anterior cingulate gyrus because sensations can trigger memories, okay? I could go into a long story about a patient who got hit in her lower back by a 2x4 by her stepfather and developed this kind of chronic pain problem much later in life that was very serious. So here's an fMRI of chronic pain. And again, just like all of you in this room, not all of you, but those that got in touch with a sensation, an emotion, and a memory, were lighting up a neuronal network in your anterior cingulate gyrus. If that's a habituated, strong, large neuronal network based on a significant trauma in your life, and you have a situation where you're injured or you develop pain, and there's a similar emotional response to the development of that pain or to the injury or the aftermath of the injury, those neuronal networks can get connected. And this is what creates the pain matrix in chronic pain. The three areas of the brain, the insula, the anterior cingulate gyrus, and the somatosensory cortex, create a negative feedback loop that's constantly feeding itself. So when an emotion, the emotions that it picks up are state dependent and they keep triggering the pain causes the emotional response, and the insula keeps jazzing up the stomach, I mean not the stomach, but the autonomic nervous system. And that's something else I would want to impress upon you, is that most chronic pain patients, in my opinion, a predominance of their pain is autonomically based, not peripherally based, in terms of the nervous system. Okay. Oh, we're auricular therapy. Am I talking fast enough? It's going to get worse. So I want to talk to you a little bit about auricular therapy because of what I said earlier about my hope that at some point in time, all interprofessional teams will have at least one person that has a broad knowledge of integrative medicine and perhaps another one that's a practitioner. Auricular therapy is a form of CAM or acupuncture, actually, that you can learn in about 3 long weekends, do about 20 or 30 hours of practicum, and get certified. It's highly affected with a whole variety of conditions. This book here has about 10 different physical or emotional problems on each page. It's a fairly big book. Auricular therapy has been used for 4,000 years in China. The Chinese aren't stupid people. They wouldn't use something for 4,000 years that doesn't work. But it was, for the most part, developed. Almost all the points of the ear were developed in France and Germany over the last 70 years. Okay, started with Paul Nozier in France. And the way auricular therapy is usually utilized in modern society is we use very subtle flat wave microcurrent through a neurostimulator that can pick up the active points on the ear and treat them and balance them. So very simply, in terms of pain, pain impulses go to the somatosensory cortex to the opposite side. So if you have a pain in your left knee, that will travel up through the rex ad lamina and into your brain and to the somatosensory cortex on the opposite side. Your autonomic nervous system, which governs all the organs in your body, also works counterlaterally. So the pain impulse is an electrical impulse. It stimulates an electrical imbalance on a certain part of the somatosensory cortex. And that imbalance gets transferred. Oh, I should also tell you, the somatosensory cortex looks like a human being bent over. The head looks larger than normal. The hands look larger than normal. But it's a homunculus. The head and hands have more nerve endings, so they're bigger. But the somatosensory cortex is then projected outward by the sympathetic autonomic nervous system onto different microsystems in the body. So that's why we can pick up all sorts of organs, problems with all sorts of organs, problems with pain, problems with even emotions on the ear. When we use these stimulators, they can tell us whether there's an electro imbalance, a positive or negative one, and they have a little button on the side of them, and it compensates for the opposite charge, okay? Almost always pain is a negative charge. So the little stimulus puts in positive energy and balances it out. This works a huge amount of the time for pain. But it usually only lasts 2 to 6 days. So, one of the reasons I was drawn to acupuncture and ended up serendipitously going to China and going back and forth to the West Coast to be trained was because as a chronic pain specialist at the time, I had a firm belief that chronic pain is different than acute pain, and it changes people's lives in many, many different ways. 88% of chronic pain patients are clinically depressed, 80% anxious. Frustration is common, anger is common, PTSD is somewhat common. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Memory and concentration deficits are common, sleep dysfunction, irritability, isolation, withdrawal, and helplessness. So auricular therapy, because it treats so many conditions, is a way in which we can treat all of these issues. There's a memory and concentration protocol, and it works. There's very, very quickly you can reduce anxiety. Depression, a little less so, but it does help. And there are just a whole variety of different protocols you can use to treat the whole person, because if you reduce anxiety in a chronic pain patient, their baseline pain level will improve, okay? But of course, the best way to take care of all of these is to take their pain away. And there are times when auricular therapy can and will do that. So this is a very simple alternative medicine approach, CAM approach, that can be learned very quickly, that's very effective with all sorts of different conditions, including some chronic illnesses, and it's something that all of you could learn. I'd love to see it offered at UNE sometime down the road as an elective. What would happen? 70% of patients entering the physician's office are driven by anxiety. What does anxiety do to the symptoms that they present with? Anybody? It can create shortness of breath. It can exacerbate pain. It can exacerbate just about any symptom with just about any chronic illness. The more anxious you are, the more likely those symptoms are going to be accentuated. So if you had somebody on your team, somebody in the office, that every time a patient walked into the office that looked really, really stressed or anxious, as many people are going to the physician, or especially the dentist, and if you're a dentist, anxiety increases the dental pain as well. So if you could reduce their anxiety in literally about a minute and a half of treatment of the ear, you would see a reduction of symptoms or a reduction of painful response, or you'd want to take the blood pressure first, but you can even treat blood pressure and it'll go down pretty dramatically in many people very, very quickly. So this would be a great addition or a great intervention system that could be easily learned by a lot of different interprofessional practitioners. Oh, wait, go back to that one. All right. These are some of the applications. There's hundreds. It's required in New York State that any detox center has an auricular therapist because it's so helpful with both alcohol and narcotic detoxification. It's used with quitting smoking. It's used with weight loss. It's used with PTSD. There's a good... there's a protocol called the HMI protocol, and it almost always calms PTSD down. It doesn't take care of the core issue of nightmares and flashbacks, but it treats the parts of the brain involved in PTSD, and it's highly successful. So very quick technique. Very quick question, case study. So I had a patient when I've always been embedded in different practices, mostly family practices, but also main neurology and orthopedic associates and some others. In main neurology, a woman had she actually had a stroke on the right side of her brain and was partially paralyzed, had all the usual symptoms. But about 2 months after the original stroke, I think, she had a secondary event where the swelling went down and all of a sudden she couldn't eat. She just couldn't tolerate eating at all. So they did exploratory analysis. They went to one practitioner or one specialist after another. They did sigmoidoscopy, colonoscopy, ulcer sounds, CAT scans, couldn't find any blockage. And finally, they got to the point where they said, because she was on IV fluids, they got to the point where they said they were going to do exploratory surgery if things didn't change. So she was sent to me, and where's the blockage? They were looking for the blockage everywhere. Where is it? Anybody got an idea? Yeah. In their head. It's in the hunger center of the hypothalamus. Okay? So this woman came to me. I met with her. We talked about history. She came in the next time, and I told her daughter to bring in some food, and I took the weight loss protocol, which involves the appetite point and a variety of other supportive points, and I manually switched the polarity of the weight loss protocol so that we were increasing appetite rather than reducing appetite. She ate that food and she never stopped afterwards. Okay? So all of that work, all the money spent on all those Western medicine tests, when history says it's something that happened up here when it stopped, okay, when there was a problem. Okay, so that's just one example. I'll keep going. Okay, this is a case. You can run the movie.
That my mind, and I still believe this today, that my mind is stronger than the shell, the bones, the shell, that my mind is more powerful than any and all of that. My years with the SEAL teams were a training like no other. Pain was something we learned to deal with. It doesn't matter how painful it gets. The injuries stacked up on one another comes to the territory. It's just they're just injuries, and I dismissed them. Both my shoulders, my base of my spine is fractured. I've got 5 herniated discs. I've been opened up surgically about 5 or 6 times in the abdomen. My right and left Achilles have been severed. My first trip in the Middle East, a year, 14 months, 15 months of daily high RF radiation exposure. Everything's is all banged up and destroyed. This part's okay. And then PTSD says, the PTSD has an association with this chronic pain like I never realized before. I would never give it to someone. But if you could give it to someone and take it back, I think the person would be like changed forever. And they would have a perspective on the disease or whatever it is like never before, like no medical journal could give them. I dread trying to go to sleep because for 20, 30 years, I average about 3 hours a night. So I know that I'm revisited and I live with that. It's there, it's always gonna be there. Exercise was always that was my go-to. When pain comes on, what do? I do what a Navy SEAL does. You drag out your bike, you run to the gym, hobble to the gym, crawl to the gym, I have to keep moving. And I do believe in that. A body in motion is a body that is going to survive. A body that stops, when that motion stops, that's it. It's over. It's really over. It's just a matter of time before the mind catches up and your mind's done too. I reach out to other resources besides people and social workers and doctors that say chronic pain is something they don't want to talk about or they don't deal with. I work with horses. I feel the horse, and that horse feels me when I'm working with that horse. And I've found nothing like it in my life. When I'm done about 3 hours with the horses, I'm good to go for the rest of the day just because of that interaction with the horses. Not every horse is meant to do everything, but every living, breathing horse has a purpose. And my purpose is more about maybe helping others in my situation. The best way for me to do that is to tell a story. There will be certain individuals that hear it. It may not be the medical profession, but I guarantee you it'll be PTSD veterans that hear it.
Some of you reviewed this case last time. So I'm assuming you know PTSD is rampant both in the military side and 12% of the general population is expected to experience PTSD in one time of their life or another. Quick, next slide. Okay. But the PTSD neuroscience is very different than the chronic pain neuroscience. I would say that RF is absolutely right that PTSD has something to do with his suffering and pain. And the reason for that is for a lot of biochemical reasons and physiological reasons, but I don't think it had anything to do with the etiology of his pain. And if you... The reason is that in PTSD, when you're having flashbacks, the anterior cingulate gyrus we were talking about that's so centrally involved in that pain matrix actually goes dormant. It's the posterior gyrus that jazzes way up. And the posterior gyrus has attachments all through the brains. And that's why when a person has a flashback, it's not a memory. It's a re-experiencing. Every sensation they felt during the trauma is there. Olfactory experiences are there. Visual experiences are there. They are there going through it all over again. And the amygdala is the source of fear. There are a couple of different hypotheses in terms of why the anterior cingulate gyrus goes dormant. One is that the power of the fear in the amygdala just overpowers the functioning of the anterior cingulate gyrus. Another could be that there's dissociation happening, as there often is in PTSD. So the gyrus would be quiet during a dissociative period. Keep going. So the key, there are a lot of associated symptoms with PTSD, but the key are the intrusive episodes, nightmares and flashbacks, and the kindled cyclical motion patterns. When you have a flashback, you're in a high norepinephrine state, then you tend to go through a dissociative state, then a depressed state, then you have another flashback, so you're on this constant roller coaster ride, which, by the way, does not help with healing. So that could have something to do, again, with chronic pain development. But I found over the years, and I wrote in a chapter in a book years ago, 20 years ago, I did support the hypothesis that PTSD could contribute to the etiology of pain. But then I saw enough patients that had been in MBAs and those kinds of things that I saw that it wasn't the actual accident and the re-experiencing of the accident. It was the emotional state they was put in after the accident if the chronic pain developed. Okay, so if the post-traumatic emotional state is helplessness, and as a child, you went through many, many, many periods, state-dependent periods, of feeling helpless in your family and like you had no power, then there's a likelihood that that large neuronal network will connect to the somatosensory cortex and cause that pain matrix to light up. So go ahead. All right, so this is a technique that I use for PTSD, and we're really running out of time. My principles in developing this is a technique that uses a combination of color electroacupuncture and a variety of Western and Eastern other kinds of techniques. There are elements of cranial electrosacral, there are elements of EMDR, elements of TIR, but you can go on to the next. All right, so I use color electroacupuncture that was originally developed in Germany by a guy named Peter Bandel. I've been able to use the color electroacupuncture machine to program intensity. We're using flat wave microcurrent. People don't even feel it because the microcurrent is what your body's already using to tell your heart when to beat, to tell your skin when to sweat, etc. I use frequency between 7.8 and 3.9. I can't go into the rationale, but there is one. Those are frequencies at which the autonomic nervous system is relatively relaxed. Schumann's hypothesis is 7.8. That's when we're very relaxed. The waveform is slope because if you do microcurrent stimulation and you just stay on 1 hertz, the brain can ignore it. If you keep moving the pattern around, the brain can ignore it. The modulation is 2-to-1, meaning it's biphasic. So keep going. So basically, I'll just describe. So what I do is I use triple warmer 3, which is on the back of your hand, stimulating it biphasically. This technique takes 20 to 25 minutes to do. It almost always resolves a nightmare and flashbacks 85 to 90% of the time. It's hugely advantageous because the patients don't need to go over and over and over the trauma like they do in EMDR and some other immersion techniques. And so I'll use triple warmer 3. I'll suggest to the patient that they go, triple warmer 3 takes you internal and you can go into your imagination and create new spaces. I ask them to create the most relaxing, peaceful room they can imagine. I then put them in a chair. I suggest the notion I'm there with a projector, and there's a screen in front of them. So what are we trying to do with this technique using color electroacupuncture? It is a modern power technique that uses modern technology and ancient knowledge. What we're trying to do is break up that pattern that we just saw in the MRI. The association triggers a tiny neuronal network in the hippocampus and flows forward down usually the right side of the corpus callosum. And all CAM practices, or most, are about changing energy systems. If we can stop that automatic flow of energy through the posterior cingulate gyrus, we can stop the memories. So all of these techniques that I just showed you, okay, we're using we're trying to disrupt that energy pattern. So if we could isolate those, the nervous impulses, neuronal impulses along that particular neuronal network involved in PTSD, when they are in a flashback re-experiencing, they would look like this, filled with anxiety and emotion, okay? Hypervigilant, okay? So we're using flat wave microcurrent in that 3.9 to 7.6 range that's going to calm them down. It's going to calm down their autonomic nervous system. We're also using biphasic treatment. So when I'm using the acupuncture probes on different acupressure points, we're stimulating one positively, then the other positively, then the other positively, and then the other positively. What that's doing is breaking up that flow of energy down that particular pathway, because we're stimulating one side of the brain, then the other side of the brain, then this side of the brain, then that side of the brain. At the same time, we're going through different acupressure points with extreme power on different emotions. And so I usually start with pericardium 8. PTSD is a condition involving primarily the heart meridian in Chinese medicine. The pericardium meridian is the protector of the heart. Pericardium 8 is the first one I stimulate. While I'm stimulating it, I know I'm running late. While I'm stimulating it, I have the person watch the movie of the trauma. So I'm working on pericardium 8, biphasic treatment, waveforms, etc. And I have them watch the movie and just tell me when it's over. So when I'm dealing with a rape victim, she doesn't have to tell me the whole gory story. All she's got to do is watch the movie and tell me when it's over. When she tells me it's over, she and I go into a partnership to change that energy flow. I ask her to watch the movie backwards, okay? Almost always, this is very surprising, almost always people can do that. So I ask the patient to watch the movie backwards and sit in them and do nothing more than pay attention very objectively to how weird and strange it is to see movements in reverse and hear sounds in reverse, and that's it. And then they get back to the beginning, they tell me. Then I fast forward the movie, telling them every scene and every image is there, but they're flying by way too quickly to respond emotionally to any of them. Just like when you're in the movie theater and they hide little pictures to tell you to go eat, but you don't see them, okay? So fast forward and then fast reverse. So at the end of that, I ask them to sit on the chair again. The anxiety, the high anxiety in the heart meridian is diminished. The anxiety in the chest is diminished. I ask them to watch again. What's the next emotion that come up? Could be a Vietnam vet that saw a friend's head get blown off in a foxhole. They feel guilty that they're the survivor. Survivor guilt's very common. Then I'll work on guilt on large intestine 1. If it's anger at a family member, I'll tend to work on heart 9. If it's grief, deep grief, I'll check both lung 7 and heart 3. So I will move from one layer of emotion to another. We'll do the exact same thing, patient and I breaking up that system by putting it forward, putting it backward, putting it fast, at the same time that the settings of the acupuncture machine are also disrupting that energy flow. So that's the long and the short of it. I'll tell you when I know it's it usually is effective, and when I know it's effective at the end, when they can sit in the chair and they say, I don't have an emotion, or I'm just watching a movie, that's obvious. But also, if they start to watch the movie, and they originally saw it in black and white, which happens a lot of the time in PTSD, and now they see it in color, I know they're never going to have another flashback again. If they start to watch the movie and they're not coming up with anything else, I'll ask them what they had for breakfast. They say ham and eggs. They are no longer having a flashback. you can't switch out of a flashback into other memories. That's what the anterior cingulate gyrus does. Okay? So if nothing erases bad memories involved with PTSD, but changing a flashback into a bad memories you can choose to think about or choose not to think about. And so, that's how it works. And I'm sorry I took so long, and I'm sorry we didn't get to Ed and some chronic pain work involving a whole different complicated new system that works very well for chronic pain.
So you just have to come back.
I would love to come back.
So these guys might have, I just wanted to have a few minutes for questions because you were just presented with an enormous amount of material. So can we do that?
Sure.
Okay. So any questions, and we also have people in the Biddeford campus. So I'm going to pass this on to you, Julia. Does anyone have a question they would like to ask?
Just quickly, how much do patients laugh and cry when they're going through this with you? Because I find that's also very powerful and very healing, and I'm wondering if it's part of your process.
With patients who are going through the PTSD?
Yeah.
Sure. I did a patient the other night who basically her brother overdosed, and her mother kept calling her, and she said, oh, it's just him again being irresponsible, blah, 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 blah. She kept at work. She went over to his house, and as soon as she drew in the parking lot, she had an intuitive sense that something really bad was going on. She went into the apartment. He was naked over the edge of the bed and no pulse. And she ended up doing CPR with him for 12 minutes or so, but his body was cold, et cetera, till the EMT got there. Obviously, this girl had pretty severe PTSD from that. So while we were working on the first couple of times through, or actually when we were working on the anxiety with pericardium mate, there weren't any tears. But the next issue that came up was grief, okay? And there were tons of tears. And so I was holding both probes in one hand and a tissue in the other, but we worked through, again, the whole process. I don't remember whether, I think it was heart three. I usually do check which is more tender, heart three or lung seven with grief. And we worked through the movie back and forth. She no longer felt that. She no longer felt that huge weeping grief. Next issue she went through was anger, and the next issue she went through was guilt. Okay? And she, this was real recently, 3 weeks ago. Okay, so it's associations with trauma that cause flashbacks and nightmares. Okay? This woman gave CPR to her dead, cold, naked brother for way too long, and I asked her the usual questions afterwards, and it was pretty clear that it changed from a re-experiencing into a memory, because she could talk about it and she could change her thought processes. She could think about being there, and then she could think about breakfast. She called me like 2 or 3 weeks later, had a new job. What was one of the things she had to do in the first week of the job? She had to do practicing CPR on a dummy. There couldn't be a worse trigger for PTSD, and she didn't have any flashbacks or nightmares. Okay? Yeah.
And this will be the last question. I know you all
make it good. I feel like some of these are not exactly traditional for Western medicine, so I was curious about what sort of pushback you've gotten from the medical community.
there are very, very conservative doctors in the medical community, but it's, I teach in the Integrative Medicine Fellowship at Maine Med. We have acupuncturists every year. Physicians who have gone to WHEALS programs and are now acupuncturists, or they've done the brief physician acupuncture training, or this and that and the other thing. And what we're seeing now is there are hospitalists now in the hospital doing acupuncture. There are Reiki healers in the hospital now doing that. Dr. Beck is an osteopath doing osteopathic manipulation in the hospital. So 10 and 15 years ago, there would have been a lot of pushback, okay? Now, because it's grassroots, 10 or 15 years ago, if I stuck a probe in somebody's ear and said, this is going to make your pain go away, they'd roll their eyes and blah, 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 blah. And then when it did, their eyes would light up, and because it was unheard of. But this is a microsystem just like reflexology, and it usually works, okay? But what I was going to say is there's so many people out there, 70% of the people going to PCPs, that have this awareness of energy modalities, that they come seeking me now, okay? And they come seeking the other integrative medicine practitioners that I work with in an integrative medicine center. By the way, I work at the Integrative Healthcare of Maine, and next year, meaning 2017, we're building a new building, and Stacy Teamy is working with the administration here and at Unicom, and we're hoping that that can be an immersion site for all your students, if you're interested in integrative medicine, to come and spend some time with our naturopath, homeopath, functional medicine doc, myself, acupuncturist, OMT, blah, 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 blah. But the answer to your question is 15 years ago, a lot more than now. But it's getting better.